Night Fan Fights number 40. Coming at you live here on Twitch.tv/Invicta. Also on the VODs at YouTube.com/Invicta316. Go to YouTube.com/Invicta316 for every single episode of Friday Night Fan Fight. Well, almost outside the ones that we had technical issues and that certain thing. But we're all set and ready to go for game at number one of the first best of three. A quick reminder to let everyone know that the signups are still open for the SS Radio Open number 5. Right now we're way short of the goal of the sign-up goal, and I'm honestly a little bit surprised that we've been having such a difficult time getting the brackets filled. And the minimum that we need is 32. So we're currently at the time of this recording/stream, we are currently 12 people short of that. So hopefully we are able to fill that. But if you are listening to this on YouTube after this has been uploaded, then the signups are now officially closed because the signups ended at the end of tonight's show. So hopefully if you are listening live and you're still interested in possibly participating, one of my mods will link the sign-up link in the chat, and yeah, go check it out. But again, if you are listening to this on YouTube, it's already too late. It is already too late because it is already it's already taken place. So we are ready to go for game number one of the first best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 40. Tonight is going to be a little bit of an abbreviated show again, much like yesterday, just due to the fact that I have been fighting off a cold. And obviously, if the tournament happens, I need my voice to be here. And of course, that involves me just kind of taking it easy. So we're going to be doing two best of threes tonight and getting rested and ready for tomorrow. So here we are, spawning on Cloud Kingdom. Spawning on the northeastern side of Cloud Kingdom, playing as the Red Zerg. I believe he is a Gold Leaguer, and he goes by the name of Conan Sun. And spawning on the southwestern side of Cloud Kingdom, I think it's the Green Terran. He's the curator of the Friday Night Fan Fights stats page, which you can find down here in the info box. Also a member of the Mosh Pit here on Twitch. You've seen him before. You'll see him again. Playing as the Green Terran, he goes by the name of Herb Chifu. So we're going to start off tonight's show with a TVZ, gold versus gold. I'm pretty sure Conan's son was a gold leaguer. And again, if you are watching this live, you have plenty of opportunities to sign up for the SS Radio Open number 5. The minimum that we can do is 32, and if we don't reach it, then unfortunately the tournament will have to be postponed, which is quite sad and disappointing to say the least. Considering this is the second time I've tried to put together the SS Radio Open number 5, and the previous incarnation of it was a Platinum and Diamond League tournament, because I had at the time last year, this was a year ago by the way, I had a lot of Diamond Leaguers and Platinum Leaguers upset that the previous 4 SS Radio Opens were gold and under. So I gave them the spotlight. I said, all right, Platinum and Diamond Leaguers, now's your chance to shine, and we had 6 people sign up. So yeah, and unfortunately we need half capacity. This is a 64 player tournament, or at least it's planned to be a 64 player tournament. But if we do not make 32, then unfortunately it cannot be done. And we have the 4 streams ready to go. It's going to be myself, Tempo, Mr. Bigface, and Returo. We're all going to be casting and quadra streaming the entire event. We're all prepared. Also have a couple admins as well, Morgan Fremen and Sage, Sage PR in the Twitch chat, both members of the Mosh Pit. They are going to be my tournament admins for the tournament if it happens, and if it doesn't happen, we'll just have to try another day. So Conan Sun did drop down the hatchery before the pool. And judging from the timing, because I was not paying attention because I was monologuing, it looks like I was going to be a 15 hatch, 15 pool. Very, very standard on Cloud Kingdom for sure. We are playing on Cloud Kingdom. You are not imagining this. This is Cloud Kingdom, and it is one of the maps in the map pool for the SS Radio Open number 5. That is done on purpose. And the reason why I did that is because I do want to show newer players to StarCraft who may not have been able to see the old Wings of Liberty maps. Cloud Kingdom was one of the best maps that came out in the vanilla release of StarCraft 2, and I think that newer players should definitely be shown some of the best maps in StarCraft 2's history. So we're going to have this Reaper now microing against the Zerglings. Should be okay as long as he doesn't bungle the micro too much. And he prioritized the drone there a little bit, so Herb Chief are going to be slightly annoying with his Reaper. He is taking up a lot of hits, and the Queen is out, which means that Reaper is not going to be able to get out of there. So first blood goes to the Reaper because he did kill the Zergling, but that is not a good trade there for one Reaper. One Reaper for one Zergling is not value. That's about as unvaluable. That's like coining into a one cost card, and then the card gets taken out anyway in Hearthstone, for those of you who play that game. So right now Konan-san just doing a multi-queen build here, getting adding on the third and fourth queen, I believe. Yep, there you go. Fourth queen is done, and he's just droning behind it. Now he is going to lose his Overlord pretty needlessly here, and that is going to supply block him, unfortunately. You really don't want to be losing the early Overlords, if at all possible, especially against Terran, because they can hide so many buildings easily. And don't forget that in my opinion at least, the Terran race has the easiest time hiding ninja expansions. Just based on the fact that they can either build the expansion in base if they want, or they can just fly it out there. So we have double Evo Chambers going down, and I don't know. I'm not too sure what Conan's son thought that he saw in Herb Chiefer's base. The only thing I can imagine is he thinks that there's going to be some sort of early pressure, which we know, of course, there's not. Herb Chiefer does have a couple of Hellions out on the field now. Army supply tab going to be slightly in favor of Herb Chiefer. Not that big of a deal, but Herb Chiefer is already on two bases, or at least he's about to be on two bases. So Conan's son needs to get a little bit more information. And again, I do like the proactiveness of sending that Overlord here. If you ever, for whatever reason, find yourself playing on Cloud Kingdom or if you are a similar-looking map, as a Zerg, especially on this map, you always want to be camping out an Overlord about right here, somewhere on this ledge where it cannot actually be hit by anything on the ground, but you can still maintain vision. This is the other common place for it if you're actually playing on this side. And that gives you full vision of at least the gas and possibly whether or not the creep is going to spread there, or you can see the workers, etc., etc. But definitely losing that early Overlord is not exactly ideal. And it is a little bit surprising to see Conan's son throw the Roachhorn down here up at the top of the base, or the top of the natural, I should say. The reason I say it's weird is just because of the fact that you could have, I mean, if this was done out of necessity to wall this off, that would have been much safer with a spine crawler. I mean, the Roachhorn is going to be a little bit more beefy, but it's not going to provide that much defense. And you're also the bigger problem of the two is the fact that if this gets taken out, where's your Roach tech? The answer is gone, dead and gone. Army supply tab now in favor of Conan's son, just by a little bit because of the 10 Roaches that are on the way now. 13 Roaches. He was banking up a lot. So Herb Chiefer is going to have some issues dealing with these Roaches. He only has 6 Hellions out here, and 6 Hellions is not enough to take out 10 Roaches. Unfortunately for Terran, the Hellions do not do well against Roaches, even Blue Flame Hellions, at least in the early game anyway. So a little bit of a rally mishap there for Conan's son. Again, not that big of a deal. Starport coming down for Herb Chiefer. He's the man who made the Friday Night Fan Fights stat sheet that you can find once again on the bottom of this in the info box of this video here on YouTube. And if you're watching this live, I think there's a macro for it. So Conan's son taking an extra half second here to get the surround on the Hellions. And yeah, those Hellions aren't doing anything, but he doesn't finish them off, however, and that is going to be a little bit wonky to deal with because if Conan's son's careful, he can actually get... Nope. Okay, he was able to micro that queen back. I was going to say, if he's not careful, the Hellions would be able to sneak through there, through that non-existent wall. And yeah, those Hellions are not going to be able to take out a hatchery. I don't care how long you take. Not going to happen. Here comes the assault on Herb Chiefer's front, and he is prepared for it. He's got a couple Marauders, lots of Marines, a couple Hellions, because hell, why not? More like Hellion, why not? Our supply tab... grossly in favor of our Zerg player right now. Those two Hellions are... God bless them, they're trying. They require all the hope and need that they want. But, all the hope and need is not going to be able to let them take out that hatchery. The re-engagement now by Conan's son pushing down the natural wall, and I think that he could just brute force this if he really wanted to. He would be trading a lot of roaches for, but they do have 1-1, and that plus 1 Carapace on the roaches just negates most of the damage that these things are taking other than from the Marauder. Whoa! That roach! That roach did not get the memo. His battery died on his iPhone. He did not check his email at the appropriate time. Use last tab is going to be in favor of our Zerg player. Again, not that surprising considering that Herb Cheever threw away 6 Hellions at the start. On top of that, he lost a couple buildings here, supply depots here and there. I think the bunker just fired upon the refinery. I'm not sure if I have confirmation or... Nope, he was firing on the Overseer. Woo, okay. I was going to say, I thought that we were dealing with gold players, but I could have been wrong. I may have missed... I've been sick enough this week at the time of this recording to possibly confuse Friday for Wednesday. So now we do have the muscular augmentation upgrade, which is the Hydralisk speed being researched for Conan's Son. And it looks like both players are going to be settling in for the macro game. Herb Cheever doing a great job keeping up with the Zerg opponent, even after he faced that early pressure going on to 3 bases already. And if we take a look at the income tab there, yeah, that tells the difference. You never, as a Zerg player, you really don't want to be on even footing or even close to even footing in the Harvesters tab just due to the fact that your Terran opponent can drop those things called mules. And if you look at the income tab for the minerals, that's the reason why. So you have to be careful with that. Make sure you're at least denying expansions of anything else. I'll take a sip of water there. As I said, I've had a pretty nasty allergy cold. At least I don't have a fever today. And whoa, that medevac! Oh, the medevac didn't make it. He only had 1 day until retirement. And those Marines in there had 1 day until retirement. Now they're on their funeral day. So that was a fully loaded medevac, and that was just unfortunate timing for Herb Cheever. And I think that, honestly, I feel that Conan Sud could possibly push this down. Whoa, SCV! That SCV got his emails mixed up with the Roach's email. He was given the okay to go order, and the Roach was given the I went to the wrong base order. I think their email addresses got mixed up. It was roach@AOL.com, not scv@AOL.com. You see the changeling now walking up, and unfortunately Herb Cheever did not catch that. Army supply tab right now heavily in favor of Conan's Son, who was just trying to max out on roaches and Hydra, which is a very, very good comp to go against what Herb Cheever has, which is not a lot. Herb Cheever does not have the mech support to deal with this. Even with Stim, this is not going to do a whole lot. Whoa, you got to be careful with the... so close with the move command. We only have 1 siege tank on the ground right now, and the medevacs still have a lot of units... still have a lot of units loaded up into them, and they're not helping. If they're sitting in the air, that is not fighting. Luckily for Herb Cheever, he didn't lose any of the medevacs that actually were almost full of units, but he really needed to get more tanks up at the front. And Herb Cheever will give up his 3rd base. Conan's Son should definitely try to expand behind this now. It looks like that's what he's going to do with this drone. Yep, there you go. I'd prefer to see him take this base over here. The only reason why I say that is because this is slightly closer to your opponent, but you're so far ahead right now, it really doesn't matter the positioning of your extra bases. Whoa, the roaches got forwarded the same email of the other roach, which was mixed up with the SCV, and here come the move command Stimpak. Bio units here for Herb Cheever. He's going to lose one of the siege tank. The other siege tank is going to fall down rapidly, and I think that is going to be that. So game one is going to go to Conan's Son, who easily pushes down Herb Cheever's front door. And I don't think Herb Cheever was expecting that many units. So game one is going to go to Conan's Son over Herb Cheever. A solid effort there from Herb Cheever. Again, he had a walkie engagement with the... He wasn't really being punished for being greedy, because that really wasn't greedy. But the problem is that he didn't shore up his defenses before taking that expansion, and it ended up costing him. But I did like the way that Herb was taking out... was trying to keep pace with the expansions against Conan's Son. He really did a pretty phenomenal job at doing that. But just unfortunately, there was not enough. So game one is indeed going to go to Conan's Son. And I may have been lobby bugged here. as has been the case. Nope, there we go. There we go, I barely made it. So we'll go ahead and get the players loaded up for game number two. Again, we are going to be going for two best of threes tonight. And that is due to the fact that I am possibly going to be casting the SS Radio Open tomorrow. I say possibly because it depends on whether or not we're going to get enough signups. And let me check as the game is loading up right now, let me check the signups here. We have a grand total of 22 people signed up. And we need 32 before the end of tonight's show. Otherwise, I'm sorry, but the SS Radio Open number 5 will be postponed again. I've done pretty much all I could do. I made Reddit threads. I made StarCraft 2 threads. Yes, I even went to Reddit. That is the extent of what Sinvicta's promotion goes. Everyone knows me. Everyone knows that I don't. I'm not a self promoter, and this is this isn't the reason why. But I just don't like. I don't know. I just don't like self promotion. Here we are spawning on the southwestern side of Daybreak. Another great classic map from Wings of Liberty. Playing as the Green Terran, he's currently down 1-0, and he's a Gold Leaguer. Can he force the rubber match? He goes by the name of Herb Tifu. And spawning on the northeastern side of Daybreak. Currently up 1-0. Playing as the Teal Turquoise Zerg. He goes by the name of Conan Sunu. Gunnison saying he's never played this map before, which is the reason why I've been bringing back these classic maps on Friday Night Fan Fights, and I plan on doing it for the SS Radio Open if it happens. The reason why that is because I believe that StarCraft players, no matter how new they are, should experience some of the best maps in StarCraft 2 history. Daybreak was certainly one that a lot of people like. I loved this map as a Zerg player. I had no problem with this map at all. Easy peasy places for your overlords here above this greenhousery. Where's the other one? There it is. Easy peasy placement for your overlords. You can always get a scout on your opponent's main base. There's so many wide open ramps that you got a chokehold here in case if you do need to be careful and shore this up with defenses or ultralisks, that sort of thing. It's a very, very good Zerg map. And also, it's just a very good overall map in general for all three races. So we're going to have that 15 hatch coming down for Conan Sun. Expect to see the 15 pool coming out any second. So we get underway for Friday Night Fan Fights number 40. Numero 40. Some people asking why did I not schedule the tournament for last week? It's because IEM was going on last week. And I wanted people to be able to watch major StarCraft events without feeling conflicted. I would never ever do anything that would be detrimental to the StarCraft community. And so it's going on the weekend. Someone said, well, school started already. Well, people don't have school on Saturday, to my knowledge, unless it's a private school or they're homeschooled. We're probably not allowed to play StarCraft in general. Just making an assumption. It's not a generalization. I'm just saying, people usually don't have school on Saturdays. Now, if I schedule the tournament for, like, say, 7:30 p.m. on a Tuesday night, then I mean, that not only is that going to conflict with school schedules, but it's also conflicting with WoW rating schedules. Kappa Troll Face. Once again, Herb Chief are moving out with the Reaper, and he's going to find the exact same thing he found the other time, which is just a hatchery building a queen and two Zergalingus. And we are back to the macro or micro war. Down goes the Reaper. Down goes the Reaper. And he's just going to keep on going. All right. Well, that Reaper saw all he needed to see. He didn't see any early third base. He didn't see anything else besides, that. I would have preferred Herb Chief at least check out the other gas to make sure that there was not an early gas for possibly metabolic boost. Again, these two are in Gold Leaguers, so it's not that big of a deal. But I do like to point out stuff for the lower levels. In case I can help them, it's my duty as the caster to try to help them out a little bit. Of course, don't go. Sinvicta is not the go-to analytical source for StarCraft 2. Don't ever, ever think that. You are misjudged if you think that I know a lot about this game. But you learned a thing or two going to Masters League, especially as Zerg. That's doing on hard mode, man. In before. I could have been GM if I played Protoss. Army supply tab non-existent for either team. We're just getting started here in game one of Friday Night Fan Fights number 40. So once again, it does look like Conan's son doing the standard four queens, and he's just going to be using that to spread the creep, take control of the map. I do like this positioning on this Reaper here for Herb Chiefer. He did take the northeastern Zonaga Watchtower, which means that he's going to be able to see anything that comes his way. It had to be Banelings or any scouting overlords, anything like that. Very good indeed. And these six Marines are going to once again kill an errant overlord. I still don't really like the decision for sending in overlords like that. I mean, one could argue, yeah, you're getting the timing down. You're understanding, hey, does he have a factory? Does he have, you know, what is he researching? Do you see any early Thors or something like that? But, I mean, at 7 minutes, there's not a whole lot that's going to change between 7 minutes and 5 minutes from what he just saw. And, again, I would much prefer to see an overlord here and then an overlord possibly, not really right here, but definitely here and one over here to get the timing on the base, or on the gases, I'm sorry. Yeah, I do like the overlord placement here. That's a very, very standard positioning. It would be a little bit better to a little bit further south just to intercept any medevacs that may be going that way. But other than that, I mean, the map vision for both these players is actually quite good. This is Herb Chiefer's vision, and this is going to be Conan's son's vision here. But again, and if we go to Conan's son's vision for a second, just look how much he can't see down here. Imagine if he just had a little overlord watch turret right here. He'd be able to see everything on the map from here to here. He may not be able to see this ramp, but you don't need to. All you need to do is just see the spot right here on the map. But again, we are talking about Wings of Liberty maps, and that's hardly relevant for part of the swarm. But I would argue that it's still relevant because it's just good practice for scouting and that sort of thing. Reading your opponent. Getting information on what your opponent is doing. That's the best thing that you can do in StarCraft, period. If you don't know what your opponent's going to be throwing at you, then how are you going to beat him? Unless you're Sinvicta and you just do the same build over and over again, then it just doesn't matter, because I'm lazy. But hey, I admit it. I never said that I have good mechanics in this game. The Zergling will spot the Reaper, although he didn't. He's on the move command, so he may not have actually seen that Reaper if he wasn't paying attention. We have 10 Banelings being morphed. He's going to be defensive Banelings. A couple Widow Mines now, and that was something that Herb Chiefer sorely needed in that last game, was early Widow Mines to take out, to get a couple really good cluster shots on those Roaches. Unfortunately, he did not make any at all, I don't believe, in that last game. Arm and Supply tab is going to be in favor of Herb Chiefer. That's only because right now Conan's son's on three bases. And this third base's economy has not started to catch up yet. It's pretty good saturation on the natural. Perfect saturation on the main. And it does look like he actually is going to deviate from his first game strategy and go straight for Mutas. The more standard TVZ Mutaling Bling play. And right now what Herb Chiefer does have, he does have quite a few Widow Mines. And how many Widow Mines does he have? He has a grand total of three. So he needs to be using that factory a little bit more to get start cranking out them double Widow Mines here. Herb Chiefer is going to be trying to make them at least one at a time, which is good. Widow Mines are fantastic units against pretty much any light unit that the Zerg has, including Mutalisks. But you really need those big cluster shots. One shot on a Widow Mine is pretty powerful, but it's not enough to kill an entire group. Now you put two or three Widow Mines focusing on the same position, then you're talking about a lot of damage. I mean, a whole lot of damage. So Conan's son just trying to get a little bit of information. He did throw out a changeling, which I do like. I wish he'd move the changeling over here. And again, it's just little nuisances like that that I like to pick up on. And once again, a very nice overlord placement. So this drop, as long as Conan's son's paying attention to the map, which he's not right now, he did not see those medevacs at all. I saw them on the map, but he did not see them at all. Now he's moved them. So he has now spotted them. Maybe he did see them with the Overlord. I caught the camera a little bit too late. Oh, Herb Chiefer! Run, Herb! No! Herb, you're wrong. Herb, you zigged when you should have zagged. A medevac can't outrun Mutalisks unless it has afterburners, which you've already used. Rest in peace. Rip in pieces, Medevac, and everyone that was on that board. Was in the these two SEVs. I don't know what. I'm not sure what email these two got. I think there may be a line of communication that's a little bit borked in the Terran Dominion. These SEVs are getting Reaper emails. They're also crossing with Roach email addresses. So we only have 6 mutilists now on the way for Conan's son, but that these mutilists have killed double the amount of units than they are, just due to the fact that they killed 2 medevacs that were completely filled up with Terran units. So Conan's son elects to allow a Hellion to move in. And we are going to get that, I believe that was +1 armor upgrade, or no, +1 weapons upgrade on the ground for the mech units of Herb Chiefer. Conan's son now focusing on the command center that was thinking about landing. This command center decided, nope, it's probably not good enough. I think I'm just going to wait. In the words of the Husky Ghost, it's getting too hot. Now, whoa, Mutalisk, got to be careful with that. Got to be careful. I'm surprised that Herb Chiefer didn't at least put down 1 or 2 Widow Mines peppering the outer perimeter of his main base. I really would have liked to see him put a couple Widow Mines here. He definitely had a golden opportunity to in this game. Conan's son has not put any pressure up until now on Herb Chiefer, and he had so many opportunities to throw down. You throw down 2, even 3 Widow Mines here, you are good. The front of your base is good. Put a cluster over here, and you're also fine. Anything that goes into your base from the ground is going to be killed, no matter what it is, unless it's Ultralisks. So now these Hellions, the Hellions took the scenic route and they paid the price. That was expensive. Whoa, the move command, Herb Chiefer, you've got Widow Mines stutter stepping. Widow Mines are not the best stutter steppers. The Banelings rolling on in, killing every single Marine, save for this small, paltry group of about 10. And the empty Medevac has lured the Hydralisk and the Mutalisk, and the Mutalisk and the Zerglings away from the front of Herb's base, but he didn't have any Widow Mines go off because none of them were burrowed. And just imagine if Herb Chiefer, even if he had half of those of the amount of Widow Mines he had there, imagine if half of them were burrowed. That would have gone way differently. But nothing you can do about it now. Herb Chiefer now moving out. He does have +2 on the ground, which is very, very good. And he needs to get in there soon. He knows about the Banelings. I don't know why he's pulling back. He could have easily stemmed up there at least to kill some of them. He saw when they were morphing. But instead, Herb Chiefer is going to back off, and he's going to yield to a big, scary army of Conan-son. Now, what Conan-son's doing right now is not really the best decision, which I feel like he's got his entire army on one hotkey group, and he's just going all over the place, chasing errant medevacs and such. Herb Chiefer lost almost every single Widow Mine. I believe these two were just built, and they're still not burrowed. He's got a Widow Mine, good unit. Widow Mine, unburrowed, not good unit. 59 Banelings now for Conan-son. And if Herb can get down, if he can calm his nerves and get down to those Widow Mines, he could definitely turn this around. I mean, I think the apt comparison for what Conan's son had is a glass cannon army. He can do a lot of damage with the Banelings, Lings, and Muta, but they've got cardboard paper for pretty much armor. Here we go again. Widow Mine still not burrowed for Herb Chiefer. And hopefully, there we go. He finally burrowed the Widow Mines, except that they're way out of position. Oh, no, and he moved the Widow Mines. Oh, he still didn't put any Widow Mines here. This one Widow Mines got one shot, and he killed 22 Lings. Very nice. Unfortunately, that was the only Widow Mine that shot this day. Herb Chiefer is going to lose his natural expansion at least. Oh, the SCVs, no! Oh, Herb, I don't even want to look at the units lost tab. Well, as a Zerg player, that warmed my heart. Herb! Like I said, as I was saying, as a Zerg player, that warmed my heart. As a caster commentator, that pained me to see. So, again, I would have preferred Herb to take at least two more of these and put them at the base of this ramp. Because this mine is at the furthest possible point from the corner of the ramp to hit anything. I mean, it did connect, but unfortunately, it didn't connect enough. So Herb has now unburrowed the Widow Mines, is going to be moving up here. These are just Zerglings, not Banelings. Oh, the Widow Mines, you got to burrow them. Or not. Or the Zerglings just don't even care. That's all right. So a Zergling run by here with these empty bunkers, and Herb is quickly falling apart. Down goes the third base. He's already lost his natural expansion. More SCVs will die. 42 killed SCVs. And Herb, you just got to go all in at this point. There's absolutely no recovery from this spot. Here come the Zerglings. This is going to be a big shot. Oh, got to be careful. The friendly fire damage coming in from the Widow Mines. So close. Herb really is lucky that only one of those Widow Mines went off. Army Supply tab in favor of Herb Chiefer, surprisingly. And here come the Banelings rolling on in. No micro to speak of. No Widow Mines support. These Marines are wishing that they hadn't signed up for the Army. This Marine. that Marine got away with his Zerg costume for a little bit there, but then it was quickly found out that indeed was just a fake. It was just a fake flimsy plastic mask. That indeed was not a Zerg unit. Units lost tab. Herb is about 3,300 gold in the hole. Whoa, Widow Mines! What are you doing, Widow Mines? Herb! No, God. Oh, Herb. Herb had so many golden opportunities in this game to come back, but he has reached the point of no return, unfortunately. More overseers now being made for Conan's son, because hell, why not? He's got almost 1,100 minerals in the bank, as well as almost 3,000 Vespian gas. And Conan's son looks like he's just prepared to send a whole bunch of Banelings to do the knockout blow. Did Herb? Oh, Herb move the Widow Mine again. No, Herb. Herb, come on. Come on, Herb. You can do it. I still have faith, Herb. Literally three Widow Mines could kill all of this. Well, now that the Ultralisk is here, it's not going to happen anymore. The Widow Mines are going to burrow. We're finally going to possibly see a good Widow Mine connection. Hopefully they don't go off on the Overlords. Don't go off on the Overlords. Come on, Widow Mines. No. Well, there was that. A bit anticlimactic. Conan's son doing the appropriate thing to group the overlords with the army. Albeit slightly reckless, but it doesn't really matter. Unfortunately, Herb had chances. I mean, you gotta point it out when you can. Herb definitely had chances to make this happen, and unfortunately, he just was not in the right place at the right time, losing all those Widow Mines at. losing all those Widow Mines that were unburrowed right here at the Zelnaga Watchtower. That is not optimal. So Herb Chiefer saying Custer's last stand. I'm pretty sure there wasn't an O in that name or a D. And Herb is going to tap out. So game two will go to Conan's son in straight sets. Very well played by our Zerg player. And again, if you do see both these players in the Twitch chat or on YouTube or just on BNet, make sure you thank them for putting on a show for you here on Friday Night Fan Fights. When we come back, we'll begin game number one of the second and final best of three here. Friday Night Fan Fights number 40. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back in just a couple of moments. And also, don't forget to sign up for the SS Radio Open number 5. Sign-ups end at the conclusion of this stream. I really hope we can fill the slots, but well, here's the hoping. Be back in just a little bit. Come on, company! set and ready to go for game number one of the second best three. I almost said number two. Here on Friday Night Fan Fights, number 40. And again, at the conclusion of this stream, the signups will be closed for the SS Radio Open. I may let it go off for another hour or so just to see if we can fill up the player slots, but it's not. I'm holding out hope. Let's put it that way. I'm really, really holding out hope. So here we are, spawning on King Sejong Jadongvu Dijon Mustard Station. Playing as the Purple Zerg, he's a Silver Leaguer, member of the Mosh Pit. He goes by the name of Hungry Lion. And spawning on the northwestern side of King Sejong Deja Vu Dijon Mustard Jadong, have your way, Toasty Subway Quizno Station. Playing as the Green Zerg. Also a Silver Leaguer. He plays as random spawn to Zerg. He goes by the name of Ogiyu. So it's going to be a random versus Zerg here. And Ogi or Ogi. I'm going to say Ogi because that's phonetically correct. Spawned as Zerg. So we are going to get a ZVZ. The drones kind of touching claws with each other. Just giving each other a bro fist there. And Hungry Lion's drone startled. I think this Overlord was actually startled by that drone. His Overlord literally stopped in its tracks there. So Hungry Lion pausing the other Overlord, who went blue, who may or may not be Tim Allen from Home Improvement. I'm not sure. It's all right. Meanwhile, the scouting drone for Augie has stopped. Inexplicably in the middle of the ramp to the natural expansion. Hungry Lion being annoying with his drone, but he is causing Augie to pull off a lot of drones from the mineral line, which is not what you want to do. Hungry Lion is going to get to throw down that hatchery first. And Augie will spot he knows that there's a hatchery there. But will he find the spawning pool? Well, we might. We might not. He sees the spawning pool. Whoa, the surround! First blood goes to Hungry Lion's group of gangster drones there. Hungry Lion getting the kill. Augie losing that scouting drone. He throws down a very, very late hatchery at the natural expansion. Again, these two are Silver Leaguers, and Augie is playing random, so I don't know how well his Zerg skills are, but we'll wait and see. Hungry Lion is spotting out exactly that, yes, indeed, there is a hatchery, and no, you will not be able to take it out with one drone. No matter how hard you try, you will not be able to kill a building hatchery with one drone. Even if you are Jadong, that's not happening. So here we go, Augie's two Zerglings looking for revenge on the drones, and got it. Hungry Lion making two Zerglings of his own now. Fourlings, actually. Also adding on two queens. Very nice indeed. So Augie just sticking with, right now, he's just now finally adding on the extractors. Unfortunately, he hasn't put anything on his natural expansion yet. So a good rule of thumb is, if you are a Zerg player, what you want to be doing, if you know that you're going to be going for an expansion at 18 workers on the mineral line, you want to change your worker rally point to this one. That way you're reinforcing it. That way you're reinforcing your mineral line and your natural, not just from your natural expansion hatchery, but also your main base. But as soon as you put the extractor up in your main base, then you have to pull those drones, or pull the rally point back and go in your base. That's called saturation. Whoa, these lings! The Ling's getting a couple wires crossed, unfortunately, and that's going to end up in one and two dead Ling's. He said, well, maybe I look like the other Ling, so maybe they won't spot me, but unfortunately that was not the case. Arm supply tab actually surprisingly dead even. How many harvesters is that now? 28 harvesters for Augie, our random silver player. The first game of Friday Night Fan, or first game of the second best of three in Friday Night Fan Fights, number 40. There is the other Zerglings. I was wondering where he got the army supply from, but there you go. So, Hungry Lion now heading out with the... How many lings is that going to be? That is going to be, let's see if I can get my math correct, it's going to be 20 lings total. And they're going to run into the 12 lings of Augie. Hungry Lion is looking like he wants to go for Banelings here. There's the metabolic boost. Nice job there with the timing from Hungry Lion. And Augie has no static defense. He is going to lose this one queen before he can get the next inject off. It wouldn't have mattered anyway. And Augie is going to lose every single drone here at the natural expansion. It's going to be 15 drones down. I don't really like this. I don't really like the decision of Hungry Lion to finish off the hatchery. I would have much preferred to see him go into the main base. This is buying Augie time to get some static defense up, although, to be fair, the only thing that's going to be safe from these three spine crawlers is, this extractor and this roach warren. They are completely fine, but the rest of the base, not so much. So Augie is desperately trying to throw down the defense, and he is going to be able to push this back. Nice job by Augie. But unfortunately, he lost his natural expansion. Again, this is kind of what I was talking about or alluding to when I said I would have much preferred to see Hungry Lion go for the main base instead of sitting there and buy Augie time by going after his natural expansion. Because had he done that, none of the spine crawlers should not have finished, and this game most likely would have been over. But again, we are talking about Silver Leaguer, so I'm just pointing it how I see it. If it walks like a duck and quacks like a Silver Leaguer, then it's probably a duck playing StarCraft, and that's very, very weird, and I doubt that the duck will be able to make Silver League. So now Augie is going to be able to deny the third base here. Very good job. This is exactly what Augie needed to do to get back in this. There's the cancel. Very nice shot by Augie. Beautiful denial of the third base, and that keeps him in this game. Now, luckily, Augie did get this third base up, which is now technically his natural expansion. So very, very nice job there. Augie staying relevant, and again, lucky for him, he did have this third base up. And did Hungry Lion actually spot that? No, Hungry Lion has no idea about that base. Armor supply tab now barely in favor of a Hungry Lion. He is going for centrifugal hooks, or centrifugal hooks if you're British. Or Canadian. Actually, the Canadian pronunciation of the word centrifugal would be centrifugal, eh? Maple leaf, maple syrup, poutine. A boot. Queen going to desperately throw her darts at the Overlord. The Overlord says, screw you guys, I'm going over here. Four roaches now making their way towards the northwestern portion of the map for Augie. Not sure why. These roaches apparently received the emails from Hungry Lion's ISP stating that we are going to attack the northwestern side of this base. This roach said, well, orders are orders. It says right here, signed by the Overmind. I guess it would be a Cerebrit. Signed by Cerebrit, Hungry Lion. And these Zerglings got the email from Augie's ISP. We're going to attack the southeastern side of this map. And the Zerglings are like, are you sure? And the Banelings are like, it's signed right here from Cerebrit Augie. So both players' armies going the exact opposite way of the way that they want to go. That's fine. Augie has been allowed to resume his construction on the natural expansion, and with the amount of money he has in the bank, he will be able to drone that up very, very easily. So we have a Mutalisk and an Ultralisk Cavern coming down now for Hungry Lion, even going for a Macro Hatch. That might be a little bit too... That might be a little wishful thinking there, Hungry Lion. No, Hungry Lion, what are you doing? You don't need a macro hatch, Hungry Lion. Hungry Lion, the 500 mineral rule only applies when you don't need to build things. For example, what is something that you need to build? A third base. What is something that you're not building? A third base. What are you building? A macro hatch. How many rounds of larvae can you get off with that? Zero. Because you only have 500 minerals in the bank. It's all right. 0-0 on Hungry Lion's army. One missile attack for Augie's army, which is comprised solely of roaches. Mostly of roaches. And now we have one and exactly one Ultralisk. And nothing else. I thought that was a changeling. My mistake. That's what I get for accidentally thinking that I was playing in this game. And the Mutalisks are now on the way. And the Zergalingus also on the way. They're going to take a fortnight to take out those destructible debris. The queen will indeed get taken out. The roach wishing that he can fire at the air. Unfortunately, it can't. And Augie with two Zerglings will be able to possibly... Never mind. Will possibly do nothing. Possibly get thrown down that ravine there. So army supply tab is going to be in favor of Augie, but... These Ultralisks, as long as they have backup, will be able to absolutely wreck these roaches if they're not microed. Oh, they're going to get the flank too. Here we go. Augie going to be crashing his units of his roaches and Zerglings. No, Ultralisk, what are you doing? We need two Ultralisks. There you go. Now the Ultralisks are engaging. And you see how much splash damage they do, but oh, that Ultralisk AI. I know it. I know it all too well. I know how awful that Ultralisk AI is. At the same time, we've got Mutalisk going after the... slightly wounding that overlord. And now the roaches have made their way into the main base of Hungry Lion, taking out not one, but a two evolution chambers. Going for the Baneling Nest, stopping, going back to the Baneling Nest again, getting poked by spine crawlers, taking it down, running away from broodlings. And Augie will now have to deal with a whole lot of Mutalisks. Seven Mutas versus that. Four Mutas versus that. The other three Mutas can only sit there and watch. Seven Mutalisks versus that. Down goes the extractor. Down goes a whole lot of things. Hungry Lion desperately trying to get up defense. Not going to happen. GG is called, and Augie takes game number one in the second and final best of three here on Friday Night Fan Fights number 30. Very nice job indeed. Played by both teams. Augie was in a lot of trouble. It was that ninja third base. And really, to be all joking aside, the lack of scouting from Hungry Lion is what caused that third base to get up and running and continue to stay up and running. Really what happened was Hungry Lion thought that he was ahead when he actually wasn't that ahead. He was ahead when he took down the natural expansion, but again, I stress that I believe that he could have ended the game had he gone just straight for the main base instead of to sit back and kill the hatchery. So hopefully, when Hungry Lion watches this on the VODs, hopefully he'll understand what I'm saying. I mean, it is nice. Don't get me wrong. It is a good thing to take down an opponent's natural expansion. I'm not saying it's not. But in that case, I would much prefer to have seen the Zerglings go into the main base and shut down the economy altogether and just end the game. It's debatable whether or not he would have been or not been able to end the game, but he could have at least definitely crippled Augie to the point where he would have not been on two bases. He would have been on basically a half a base at that point, and then your Zerglings have free to do whatever they want. At the very least, you're going to force a pull-off on all the drones from the main base, and that's what you want to do. What you don't want to do is to do that, to give your opponent an opportunity to actually get caught up in the game, and unfortunately that's what Hungry Lion did. Again, that and the combination of lack of scouting on the third base meant that he thought he was ahead when he really wasn't. Game one will go to Augie, the random player. And the players are loading up right now for game number two, which is possibly going to be the last and final game here tonight. And again, I am going to err on the side of caution in anticipation of possibly the tournament taking place. I want to make sure that my voice is ready to go for it. But it's a good chance right now that it might not take place. Hopefully so, because I would hate for it to cancel again. But I will do it if I have to. And the game is loaded. Here we are, spawning! A Neoplanet S, another one of my classic favorite maps. Playing as the Purple Zerg once again. Member of the Mosh Pit currently trailing 1-0. Can he force it back and go to game 3? The Silver Leaguer goes by the name of... Hungry Lion! And spawning on the northeastern side of Neoplanet S, playing as now the Green Terran. Plays a random spawn as Terran this game. Also a Silver Leaguer, currently up 1-0. He goes by the name of... Ogiyu! So let's see if Augie's Terran is just as good as a Zerg. Hopefully Hungry Lion will take away a couple of notes there on that last game. Of course, this is now a ZVT instead of a ZVZ, so any notes that you may or may not have will be null and void. Again, Neoplanet S, one of my favorite maps from Wings of Liberty. Very, very, very good map. Or Heart of the Swarm, actually. I think, come to think of it, I'm pretty sure that Neoplanet S was debuted in Heart of the Swarm. I don't believe that Neoplanet S was actually part of Wings of Liberty, now that I'm thinking about that. And, oh no! Hungry Lion, don't lose this drone! Build your hatchery! Oh, you can't build your hatchery! Retreat! Alright. Go back. Move that. No. Move this. You can just move it. Attack it. Hungry Lion going for the third base for his natural expansion. So if you ever find yourself as a Zerg player in a position like this on a map that's similar to this, what you want to be doing, if at any, for whatever reason, you can't take your natural expansion, don't take the one that's catty corner all the way over here. You want to take the one that's parallel to your main base. This is a much easier location to defend than this one, in my opinion anyway. Some people would argue that, well, you could always just reinforce here with Mutalisk, but honestly, how are you going to reinforce the Mutalisk by the 7-minute mark when the first Bioforce hits on your natural expansion, or sooner, depending on if they have a Reaper or something like that? Good luck trying to micro a queen all the way from your main base to your third base here. There's no way you're going to have the creep spread for that. I mean, the same holds true here for basically what you don't want to do is to find yourself with your natural expansion being at your third base. But if at all possible, if you have to do this, go for the nearer one, go for the parallel ones. Much easier to defend. So Augie, suspecting nothing. Whoa, Hungry Lion says, well, if you're going to delay my nat, I'm just going to take it anyway. Especially since he does know that Augie does have a natural in-base expansion being built right now. There you go. So the third base for Hungry Lion is up. And this is actually kind of bad for Augie. He's going to think that this base has been up here for a little while now. And it does look like he is going to go back. No, he's going to be checking. Okay. I don't know. I'm not sure why Hungry Lion would ever have a base there, but that's all right. At the 5-minute mark, you're usually not going to be on four bases. You have to assume right now that your opponent's probably taking their nat. So Hungry Lion doing a pretty bold move here, but it's actually in reality the correct move. If I were playing, I would have done exactly that, except I would have built my third base here. And to elaborate on the reason why I'm saying it, if you do have parallel bases like this, obviously we're not going to be seeing Neoplanet S anymore, but hypothetically, if you find yourself a similar scenario, it's much easier to connect creep here, here, and here than connect it all the way around this and this and this and this. It's just like that's about the extent of maybe 3.5-4 creep tumors. So Augie going to be getting that natural expansion up there with the command center. We get overlord placement there coming in from Hungry Lion, who's currently trailing the series 0-1. Our supply tab going to be in favor of Hungry Lion because Augie hasn't made any military units save for a couple of Marines. Right now, Hungry Lion definitely has a pretty good opportunity to do some early game damage with his economy. As soon as these three bases kick in, he's going to have more money than he knows what to do with. And if Augie is not prepared, if Hungry Lion decides to go for, like, just maxing out on roaches or something like that, or even going for Mutilus at that point, he will have the economy to do so. Well, he would if he took more than one gas, but he's not. Hungry Lion now moving out with 24 lings. Actually, this is not 24 lings. What you talking about, units tab? This is only 14 lings by my count. 8, 6. There we go. There's the other 10 lings. Welcome out, 10 lings. 24 Zerglingus ready to go. One Widowmine, which will probably kill all of them. Widowmine is armed. There's Zerglings pacing back and forth. And waiting. They have metabolic boost. Is Hungry Lion going for Banelings? No. It's Widowmine licking its chops. Seven kills from the Widowmine. The Lings are now moving into the natural expansion. And running away because they saw the second Widowmine. And unfortunately for a Hungry Lion, that other Widowmine is ready to go. This Widowmine is already a corporal. This Widowmine out. This Widowmine has command over all these units combined. These are all recruits. This is a corporal Widowmine. How embarrassing would that be to go back into the barracks after a long day of training out on planet Neo Planet S to say, man, oh man, work was tough. What happened, Fred? Well, Corporal Widowmine, he got the promotion that I was really looking forward to. Well, how did they give it to a Widowmine? Well, I mean, he did kill seven of the enemies. Well, how many did you kill, Fred? Well, I kind of sat there and didn't do anything, but I thought about it. Well, they don't really get promotions out for thinking about stuff, Fred. Yeah, but I mean, like, the Widowmine is just an inanimate object. It doesn't do anything. How many kills did you get? Well, zero, but I thought about getting a lot. And how many did the Widowmine get? Well, seven. Well, I guess you better start saluting the Widowmine then, Fred. He's got superior rank over you. Two medevacs now moving out to the somewhat third base-ish. Hungry Lion. Arms fly tab in favor of Hungry Lion. I believe these are all Marines. Yep. So here we go. It is going to be a Clash of the Titans here. 16 Lings. And 31 roaches. All walking back to the third base. Thanks to the positioning of just two medevacs. Zerglings helplessly shaking their fists on the ground, saying, get off my lawn. You get back here. Ooh. Shake your fist harder. That'll show them. Two Marines. Oh! Barely get the airlifted out. Hungry Lion pulled every single drone. Are those the drones from the third base? I think they are. Yep. That would be way too many drones. So Hungry Lion trying to take out as much as he can. He gets three of them. He gets three Marines, or two Marines. No, he got three Marines. Look, it doesn't matter. Hungry Lion getting harassed to the max here, and what you should be doing outside of dealing with the drops, which is I'm not faulting him for, but you should definitely start throwing down two sport crawlers at each base. And Augie going for the Buzz Bomb expansion. Yes, indeed. That is the expansion that Buzz Bomb took many, many years ago. Bronze League Heroes. 0-0 for a Hungry Lion. Now we have more medevacs. Making the way of the Lings, all right. All right, we got the plan now, guys. We're ready to go. And run past a easily killable expansion. Oh, we weren't there to save in time. Get back here, Medivacs. I would have made it there if it weren't for you dastardly Medivacs. So Hungry Lion didn't resaturate his third, which is good because he probably would have lost them all there. One base falls to the Terran dropships. Two bases fall to the Terran dropships. Hungry Lion, unfortunately, giving a good example as to what happens when you don't split up your army. But again, these are two Silver League players, which we're not going to beat them up for. The Medivacs taunting, holding control, and tapping the three key over and over again. Spamming the laughing emotes. Laughing in the face of the Zerglings who can't possibly reach them ever. The Queens were able to take out one of the Medivacs. Very good. But unfortunately, Hungry Lion did lose not one, but two bases. Now the Doom Drop back in the main base. Finally, the Mutas have appeared, and they have already died. And Hungry Lion's going to call GG, and that is going to do it. So Augie takes the game in two straight sets. Unfortunately, we never got to see if Corporal Widowmine would have been able to make it. It would have been nice. It would have been good. That's going to do it for Friday Night Fan Fights tonight, everyone. Thank you for watching. Do appreciate it. And again, remember that the sign-ups will be ending. I'll go ahead and extend it for another hour at the time of this recording, but of course, if you are listening to this on YouTube, then the time has already expired. Hopefully presenting to you the SS Radio Open tomorrow. Again, follow my social links, and I will let everyone know. Thank you for watching. I am going to be running a brief block of ads here on Twitch. Thank you for watching, everyone, for those of you on YouTube as well. Check the links down below for your match shortcuts and links. And I will see you all next time here on Friday Night Fan Fights. So long, everyone. Have a great weekend.